We're good? Okay, well, what we're going to do is take a look at the review of, this is sort of an overview of synoptic meteorology, but primarily QG theory, frontogenesis, some of the stuff that you will see and ends up being a building block for trying to make the forecast. So again, we'll go over this and then we'll, in our break, we can take any questions. This is going to be the easiest version of the QG height tendency equation you've ever seen, because that's it. We're just going to wave the magic wand and we don't have any of the other nasty details. So it's essentially two terms. Once we make all of our assumptions and simplifications, the nasty version of it, of term one, is geostrophic advection of vorticity by the geostrophic wind. Now, we should know that the wind is not perfectly geostrophic in the real atmosphere. So it's a pretty good first order approximation, though. So you're not going around, if you were to calculate this using numerical model output or something like that, you would want to use the geostrophic wind. But the point is, if you're looking at weather maps, we plot the real wind. So it's the total wind and all the mess that's involved with that. It's usually a good enough approximation, and there are ways to tell if the flow is highly ageostrophic. Point here is that cyclonic vorticity advection corresponds to height falls. So where the vorticity is increasing with time, the heights are falling. That's generally where you would expect a trough to move. The other one's just the thermal advection term, which in this case, it's the change in height of thermal advection. We're looking for a max or a min somewhere in the column. So in the case here, if we have differential cold advection, there's a level at which cold advection is maximized somewhere in the atmosphere. The column, in terms of thickness, shrinks around that maximum cooling. If you're below that, you'll see height rises. And if you're above that, you'll see height falls. So again, differential thermal advection for height change and just cyclonic vorticity advection. So that's for the QG height tendency equation. Again, we can summarize this in text, and most of this is the same stuff that Ariel already talked about. He went through in the derivations. You're just looking for maxima in thermal advection in the column if you're looking for height falls or height rises, and then you're looking for cyclonic or anticyclonic vorticity advection. So it works the same way, and when we get to the omega equation, it's literally you just flip that around. It's just thermal advection and differential vorticity advection. So that's really the main thing to remember. Here's a real-world example of what this looks like. We've got here, we're assuming the maximum in cold advection. That would be this area up here along the California coast, which, if I can get the mouse back, there we go. This area here, this is a maximum in cold advection. We're just assuming that that's the maximum in the column. It's weaker above and below that. And so we would expect if there's a maximum in cold advection there, there should be height falls above that. So say 500 millibars, you should see the heights fall in relation to this maximum in cold advection. And we also have to consider the vorticity advection term. Now this is one where I don't have the actual advection on there, but if you look at where the contours cross, this is the height contours cross the vorticity isopless somewhere along roughly San Francisco into maybe a little bit of the Central Valley. And then eventually as you go east, the contours are parallel, so the advection is strongest somewhere in here. So some combination of the cold advection up here, vorticity advection down here, you combine the two. Now this is what has happened in the previous 12 hours. You see that the heights of the 500 millibar pressure surface have fallen the most in result to the combination of cyclonic vorticity advection and differential cold advection, or max and cold advection somewhere below that level. So that's how you would use that information to determine where is this synoptic wave going. Is it going to amplify? Which way should it move? Okay, the omega equation, again, simplest version you'll ever see, and it's just kind of a flipped around version of what we saw for the height tendency equation. Except in this case, we've got differential advection of absolute geostrophic vorticity, geostrophic wind, blah, blah. It's primarily going to be just differential vorticity advection is what we're looking for. So if cyclonic vorticity advection increases with height, that's a contribution to vertical motion or ascent. And then the thermal advection term is straightforward. Warm advection is ascent, and I'll show you what that looks like on an isentropic surface. And differential CVA is also a contributing factor for ascent. Now the other thing to remember with the QG omega equation, if you remember, there's the sigma term, which is 1/sigma, that's a static stability scale. Steeper lapse rates amplify the response. So if you have an unstable profile, the vertical motion response will be smaller scale and stronger than you would get in a statically stable environment. Okay, so the vertical motion, again, you can just summarize this, and the key thing is just remember, you're looking for differential CVA and thermal advection for omega, and you're looking for CVA and differential thermal advection, you just flip it around, for height change. So it's not too hard, or hopefully not too hard to keep up with that. That's the part you're going to use day-to-day weather, trying to make a forecast or judge the quality of a numerical model forecast. Okay, here's a real-world example of what it looks like, two different ways to look at the thermal advection term. That gaudy color, this yellow area here, this is a maximum and geostrophic thermal advection on the 850 millibar pressure surface. So it's maximized over Maryland, Pennsylvania. I mentioned isentropic is another way to look at this. An isentropic surface is, we're just assuming that it's adiabatic, the flow. So technically there wouldn't be any condensation, which might be violating cases with precipitation. But here, if you look at the way I've got the pressure surfaces labeled, this is 800 millibars, 850, 900. If you look at the direction of the flow on that theta surface, it's going from higher pressure to lower pressure. That's upglide. It's literally, think of it as going up a ramp. So when we go back to the previous slide, this one, the flow is not constrained by the pressure surface. It's not, you know, the air is not flowing at 850 millibars and staying there. It's literally can be moving through the pressure surface, but when we go to the isentropic surface, the air, more or less, it's a better approximation that it's staying on this isentropic surface. So in this case, warm advection is isentropic upglide. They tell you the exact same thing. It's just two different ways to look at it. All right, the other term in here, so this is the same case we were looking at for thermal advection. Here, this is differential cyclonic vorticity advection in blue. This is just straight from the SPC mesoanalysis page. There's differential CVA downstream of this shortwave trough. No big surprise there. Same area, we have low-level warm advection maximized, and you see the precipitation echoes are in the zone where the warm advection and the differential cyclonic vorticity advection overlap. And this is pretty typical. Now, in storm cases, it will probably look a lot different than this, because when you have large buoyancy and low static stability, you don't tend to see these big stratiform areas of precipitation. It'll contract way down into intense convection, and it probably wouldn't look like this. But the idea is to understand the background processes first. Okay, frontogenesis, it may have been mentioned, I don't think you guys have talked about it a whole lot, but it's another thing that we would want to consider here. Point is, the atmosphere doesn't like changes in the temperature gradient. If it strengthens, the atmosphere will try to weaken the gradient. If it's weakening, it'll try to strengthen it. So in the point of frontogenesis, if you're strengthening the temperature gradient, how would you weaken it? You need to cool the warm side, and you need to warm the cool side, which would spread the gradient out. That's what the vertical motion field does. So you get ascent on the warm side of a strengthening front and subsidence on the cold side of a strengthening front. And these are zones that also you have enhanced advection. You've got a tighter gradient to begin with. So all the QG processes are tend to be maximized along these enhanced thermal gradients. They're corridors for cycle genesis. And generally, we're talking about thermal gradients in the lower troposphere, something you'd see at the surface up through about 850 or 700 millibars. So again, these are all, the whole point here is this stuff is all tied together. You know, the corridors of cyclogenesis, frontogenesis, the QG forcing for ascent, height change, they all tend to be related to where the gradients are strongest. So these are, you know, kind of a big surprise. It's with the strongest synoptic waves and the strongest fronts. Okay, we can illustrate this with a jet streak. I believe y'all talked about it a little bit. Well, this is just the frontogenesis explanation for the vertical motion that you get with a straight jet streak, which is a pretty unrealistic one. You don't see very many straight jet streaks. But just in this case, we have my fancy animation, air parcel moving through. What it's doing is, as you're coming toward the jet core, you're encountering a stronger gradient in temperature. That's, from the parcel's perspective, that's frontogenesis. As you exit the jet core, you're encountering a weaker thermal gradient. That's frontolysis. So the response of the atmosphere as the parcel moves in is to offset the frontogenesis through vertical motion, and the way to do that is cooling on the warm side, which is the right rear quadrant, or the right entrance region of the jet core. In this case, would be the A prime down here is the right entrance region. So there would be ascent to try to cool the profile, and there would be descent in the left entrance region to try to warm. So what it's trying to do is offset the frontogenesis. The exact opposite happens in the exit region. Now it's encountering a weaker gradient. So remember, air parcels move through the jet core. This isn't, it's not a chunk of air moving along by itself. There's air accelerating through the Titan gradient. And so frontogenesis can describe the jet core vertical motion quadrants. The same thing can be done, and I believe y'all did it with the QG omega equation, with differential vorticity advection alone, gives you the exact same explanation. So I'd encourage you to go back and look at that. There's multiple ways to explain these processes on the large scale. Okay, so the jet streaks, again, they're with stronger temperature gradients, the air moves through, and it's the same thing that I just summarized. And the key is the response to it. And as long as you understand how these processes work, there are multiple ways to get the same answer. It's not like you say, well, jet streak dynamics are the only thing I can apply in this case. That's usually not true. You could apply QG, omega, anything else, any of these other processes. You could look at warm advection. You could look at flow on an isentropic surface. You tend to get the same answer, which is a good thing. These are not competing theories. They're actually just different ways to state the same thing. Okay, the thermal wind. Now this is one, this starts getting into changes in the geostrophic wind with height. It's not a real wind, but it's a way to explain the response in the atmosphere to changes in thermal advection with height or changes in the gradient with height. The important thing here is that a veering wind with height, a veering geostrophic wind with height, infers warm advection, which is related to vertical motion. So now you don't have to look just at a pressure surface or an isentropic surface. You can simply look at a wind profile. And if the flow is largely geostrophic and you have a veering wind with height, you've got thermal advection. Cold advection is just the exact opposite. So it's a backing wind with height. We're interested for storm purposes. The warm advection profile is the one that we're primarily interested in. And again, if you have a thermal gradient, the vertical shear, there tends to be a shear in the vertical wind, which is related to the thermal wind. The stronger gradients in the low troposphere, the strongest flow tends to be sitting above those in the middle and upper troposphere. So that low-level fronts are important. You find where they are in the lower troposphere, you can actually predict where the jet core will likely be aloft before you even look at the data. And the reason, you might say, well, why would I do that? Why not just look at the stuff aloft? Point here is, first of all, I'm going to give you exercises coming up, not today, but where you're going to be asked to make assumptions based on limited data, and you need to have these conceptual models. And I can tell you from personal experience, the easier it is for you to piece this stuff together conceptually, the less time you're going to waste on the mechanics of going through the meteorology and a forecast, and you're going to spend that time wisely on thinking about what it means for the forecast. So if you don't have the mechanics down, you get lost in all the details and you don't even think about the forecast. And that's what happens to a lot of budding meteorologists, as they get tied up in the details. Oh, why would I look at this? And you need to get that part down. So we're not talking about this just, I'm just some windbag and I want to say, hey, this is, someone's make it twisting my arm and making me talk about this. I use this stuff weekly. So it's very helpful. And if you can get to where you understand it in a basic sense, you can really help yourself as a forecaster. Okay, well, I'll just show a real-world example. This is the 850 millibar analysis. Somebody might recognize the date. This is 0Z, April 28th, 2011. There was a little bit of weather that day in the southeast. 200 tornadoes, and it's basically the tornado outbreak of a generation was ongoing at this time. But if you note where we have the strong thermal gradient, I've sketched in the front here, 850 millibars. It's across Mississippi. We note what happens with height. There's a tilt to the system, and this is what we mean by a baroclinic wave. It tilts to the northwest with height, so the gradient in the low levels tends to slope upward. So again, a front is not on a pressure surface, it's not a two-dimensional object. It's actually a sloping three-dimensional surface is what you're really thinking of, and that's what an isentropic chart will show you, is if you pick the right theta surface, you can actually see the slope of the front. And instead of being gradients in temperatures, it would be gradient in pressure would show you that slope. Okay, so notice what's sitting right above the tight low-level thermal gradient, the jet core. So it's no accident. This is essentially just a real-world demonstration of the thermal wind concepts. Okay, baroclinic system, I just mentioned that. The importance of a baroclinic system is that you have advections going on. You have a system where there's thermal advection, vorticity advection. You can lead to vertical motion, system movement, system amplification, and then also, as I mentioned here, the last little bullet, differential advection in a thermodynamic sense can lead to destabilization. And again, you will tend to see veering wind profiles in the warm sectors of baroclinic waves because the atmosphere, it's not fully modified, and that gives you a large clockwise photograph. We'll talk about that with the supercell tornadoes. It's just a little bit relevant. So baroclinic waves are what you're looking for. And then, of course, jet streaks are associated with vertical shear. And I know that's another big shocker that a max in the wind aloft would come in and there'd be vertical shear increases. But point is, you need to look for the path of these baroclinic waves because it is relevant. So again, the stronger gradient of the ground, this is a case we just showed you. You notice at 500 millibars, it's sloped back to the northwest. This is just a classic baroclinic structure with a slope usually to the northwest or to the west or southwest with height. And that's typical in westerly flow. Now, equivalent barotropic, a little less interesting, and this is sort of a specialized case. We've got all the thermal contours are parallel to the height contours. There's really no advection, and you tend to not have the same vertical shear, and you don't have the same advections. You don't get the amplification of the system. You don't get the motion. And that's what these systems look like, these closed lows cut off from the main belt of flow. And then if you notice here, this is 850 millibars. At 500, it's vertically stacked. And you notice all the flow, it just looks circular. It's all just, and there's little advection of any kind. So it's hard, a system like this, from a QG perspective, has no excuse to move anywhere. If there's no thermal advection, no differential vorticity advection, it's not going to go anywhere. It's not going to amplify. If anything, it's just slow spin down process. And then that also says something about the vertical shear profiles. You don't have these big cyclonically curved hodographs in the warm sector of these closed lows. You don't tend to see that. So for severe storm cases, baroclinic waves are much more interesting than equivalent barotropic. Okay, so the key here in all this, the whole point I've been trying to get to, through all of this and all of the stuff you went through with the derivations, and you know, I looked over that, and it's like I don't envy you. I remember doing it myself. You want to have solid conceptual models for how you deal with the overall synoptic environment. You want to know why you should expect ascent. I mean, your other option is you could just let a numerical model do it for you, and you have no job, because that can be automated right now. So you want to have something to say, okay, why should I expect there to be ascent? Because a numerical model is much more complicated than a quasi-geostrophic framework, but a lot of times there are details in a model output that are going to mask the important large-scale processes. Again, stronger gradients, stronger advection, stronger ascent, stronger height falls, it's all interrelated. And the important thing here is that we want you to be able to apply these concepts to figure out, how do I set the stage for severe thunderstorm development and maintenance? It's not just an exercise in where is this trough going to go or is it going to amplify. Where will it be favorable for severe thunderstorms? So we've already given you some of the basic ingredients, and you know, I'll follow up with some more stuff that I think is a little bit more specific. But the idea here is tie it all together, have an understanding of large scale. As soon as you do that, you can shed a lot of these wasting time with the mechanics, and you're actually thinking about the process. And I can tell you that just these simple concepts can help you put out a superior forecast at times compared to the most sophisticated numerical model. Pick any version of the HER you want, any run, whatever your favorite is, the 4 kilometer Nestle ARW that's run for us at SBC, whichever one you like, pick that, and I guarantee you can outperform those at times using these simple large-scale processes, just the conceptual model to represent them. Okay.